16, verse 58 in the Bible, that in quotes, "Therefore, my dear brothers and sisters, stand firm. Let nothing move you. Always give yourselves fully to the work of the Lord, because you know that your labor in the Lord is not in vain." So we need to labor not in vain. Therefore, transformation means a qualitative leap, not just quantitative expansion. Because you remember I'm saying all this because the topic you brought was leadership for transformation. So I have to first of all give you my views on what is meant by transformation itself. It is quantity metamorphosing into quality. By 1400 AD, many of the African societies were a bit like the European ones at that time. They were late Iron Age and were three class societies. The class of the feudalists, the class of the artisans, and the class of the farmers. By 1400, Europe was a three-class society, so was Africa. However, by the time of the French Revolution, the European society had metamorphosed into a four-class society. And the classes were the old feudalists, a new class known as the bourgeoisie, the middle class, a new class known as the proletariat, the working class, and the old residual class of the peasants, the farmers. It is the new classes, the bourgeoisie, the middle class, and the proletariat, the working class, supported by one of the old classes, the peasants, that caused the French Revolution of 1789. Since that time, European society has undergone further transformation with the shrinking of the feudal class and the disappearance of the peasants, of the peasant class. If you go to Europe today and you look for peasants, you are not going to get them. If you advertise on the TV and you say, "I'm looking for peasants in Europe," you may not get a single one. They are not there. They have disappeared, positively, not dying, but they have changed into something else. Today, therefore, Europe is a two-class society, the middle class and the skilled working class. The middle class contains active entrepreneurial elements, and the working class is skilled workers. It is these two elements that have propelled Europe through the three industrial revolutions and are now pushing it into the fourth industrial revolution, the one of artificial intelligence. The problem with Africa has been that in the last 600 years, the African society has not metamorphosed. It has not been transformed. On the contrary, in some aspects, the African society has regressed, has gone backwards. How? The African artisan class was wiped out by the colonial imports. Their artisan products were now monopolized and replaced by the colonial products. Plates, spoons, cooking pots, textiles, leather products, all these were now imported instead of using the ones by our artisan class. So the African artisan class disappeared. The only class that survived was that of the peasants who were put to growing colonial cash crops, coffee, cotton, tobacco, tea, palm oil, for supplying the colonial industries. With the independence, although a lot of time was lost with military governments engaged in primitive fascism, nevertheless, many of the African governments have correctly identified two crucial stimuli that can catalyze social transformation. These are education and health for all, what is normally called human resource development, and private sector-led growth. The two, education and liberalism in the economy, have the potential to cause social transformation. Especially the importance of the private sector was not clear to many African leaders. Here in Uganda, both Obote and Amin interfered with the private sector with the Nachivubo announcements of 1970 and Amin's expulsion of the Asians in 1972. You can see the blindness. What Mzee Obote did in 1970 to confiscate the few companies that were here, and Idi Amin to completely expel the Asians who were part of our private sector. Total confusion that they were sucking us. Sucking what were they sucking? Somebody is producing sugar for you. Instead of importing it, and you declare him a problem. The president is there, ministers are there. You can't believe it. Because they did not understand the importance of the private sector. It is the NRM, our party, that firmly rejected this mistake by returning the properties of the Asians and liberalizing the economy. Because when we came and we analyzed, that's pseudo-nationalism. Pseudo-nationalism, saying that, used to call it economic war, that he was indigenizing the economy. But the Indian has got a shop in one place. Uganda is 240,000 square kilometers. Why don't you go and build your own shop somewhere else? Why do you have to take the one of the Indian? So when the NRM came, we had to fight a conceptual battle with these people who said, return the property of the Indians. And when we were struggling to do that, the whole parliament was full of people who were sitting in Indian houses. So I almost developed throat cancer, persuading them that they should leave Indian houses and go and build their own houses. And the Indian houses were just 4,000. Can you imagine 4,000 properties in the whole of Uganda? If you look at Kampala and Tele now, you will find maybe 1 million properties of the Africans, which they have built themselves when I chased them from the Indian houses, from the 4,000. They have built more. Kampala and Entebbe, and they are now one town, built by the Africans, not by foreigners. But that was after I chased them from Indian houses. Because the Indian houses were Ekisirani. Ekisirani is never like Swahili. Like Swahili. Oh. Ekisirani is bad luck, something that can cause you problems. But these people thought that Indian houses, So that conceptual confusion is very, very dangerous. Mistake of imprisoning us in these hot tents. Instead, they opened the windows and you can enjoy the breeze of Lake Victoria. Normally they keep out the air and then they bring it in with very cold. These air conditioners are not comfortable. It really heat you as if you are meat in a freezer. But I'm glad this time they have done it well. I'm glad these young people have started a think tank. We have many think tanks, especially in the West. However, those think tanks don't think about Africa. They think about Europe, about the West, mainly. We are trying to start a think tank with the Prime Minister of Malaysia, Dr. Mahathir Mohamed, in the Commonwealth, which is based in London, called the Smart Partnership. But it has been having a lot of challenges. I liked it because it was a think tank that was like independent. However, it's good that these people, the young people, have started this think tank, which should try to broaden. Because when we introduced the members, many of them are Ugandan, and that's not broad-based. The one and only Ugandan I had was my sister from Ghana, the daughter of Dr. Nkrumah. Stand up and they see you. That one was good value addition to your think tank. And then Rosa Malangu. From Equatorial Guinea, but that's not enough. You need to have more. Who are the others? Have I left out anybody? Dr. Who? Who is Dr. Corinne? Who is he? But you are not sitting with this group. So you should have more broad base. Now, I was asked to speak on leadership needed to catalyze Africa's transformation. We first need to understand what is meant by transformation. That word, transformation. In the 1960s, economists were talking about growth and development. In the 1960s, our academicians spent quite a lot of time talking about growth and development. Growth was supposed to mean quantitative expansion of the respective sectors, e.g., grow more cotton, grow more coffee. That was supposed to be growth, quantitative. The numbers, grow more of this, grow more of that. Development was a term that implied some qualitative changes, not only quantitative, but qualitative. Propelling the sustainable. Is it healthy to have sustainable pregnancy? This means pregnancy that is indefinite. The answer is that it is neither feasible nor desirable to have sustainable pregnancy. In the pregnancy, we have the microcosm of both the quantitative expansion, the baby growing in the womb, and the qualitative leap after 9 months, when the pregnancy transforms into a baby, breathing through the nose, eating through the mouth, etc., instead of previously doing comparable activities through the umbilical cord. It is the same organism going through the different forms of life. In biology, they call it metamorphosis, where the insect goes through the different forms of life: egg, caterpillar, pupa, and mature butterfly. It is the same organism going through the different forms of life. Similarly, the same applies to society. Ever since the evolution of man from the earlier primates into the Homo sapiens 4.5 million years ago, the society of the people has been evolving from the hunter-gatherer communities that dwelt in trees, tree dwellers, cave dwellers, with the invention of fire, using ever-changing tools, stone tools, brass tools, iron tools, guns later, spears, the domestication of crops, that is agriculture, instead of hunter-gathering, the domestication of animals, that is pastoralism, through feudal times to the Industrial Revolution with its earlier three stages: the use of the steam engines, the discovery of electricity and rail transport. All these changes have been transformational, not just quantitative changes, but changes involving qualitative leaps. These are what we mean by transformation, not just increasing quantitatively, but also assuming a higher quality. After independence, you know, the problem I have with that, what many of you people call history, I call current affairs. This is the problem, because I've been there all the time, just watching. So when you hear people saying they are reading history, I said, what history is this? I was there. So after independence, I used to hear leaders talking of double production. You know, politicians like slogans. They like slogans. Somebody comes and says, now we want double production. Then the whole country goes, double production, double production, double production. Meaning, more production of the same product, raw materials. That's what the double production meant. Produce more and more coffee, but the same. It remains as a raw material, but more. And I'm glad this group have really got themselves, because now you should go back and do research. What I'm saying here, you go and get the data. Because me, I remember the events, but you need data to support them. That double production did not help as long as we are at the same qualitative level, producing raw materials and not adding value to them ourselves. Cotton is not only for clothes, like the one I'm putting on. Because the other day we were having an exhibition here in Namalele, and we had our scientists there. With a PhD, and she was showing cotton is good for cloth, the cotton seeds are good for cooking oil, then after you remove the cooking oil, the cotton residue, you can make animal feed. So I looked at the professor, doctor. Said, is that all? Yes. I said that, but we make gunpowder from cotton. Ah, but gunpowder is not for Africans, it is for. So while the cotton price was collapsing, one of the countries in the world was buying a lot of cotton. Why was it buying a lot of cotton? To make gunpowder from the cotton. As I speak today, the countries which produce gunpowder in the world are very few. All the others buy from those few clever people to come and pack. You buy the powder, you come to park here, you say, I have got a munitions factory. Even Uganda does it, we buy. But I've been telling this Uganda, but you should be selling the world gunpowder, not you buying. But the idea of qualitative had not sunk very deeply in people's heads. The expansion of affluence to China, India, and Brazil also saw the recovery and even the soaring of commodity prices. The commodity prices in the 1960s, 70s had collapsed because the rich people were only in Western Europe and the United States. With China trying to get out of poverty, and India and Brazil, the demand for commodities now came up. Because the Chinese were building better houses, instead of staying in straw huts, Indians were building better houses, Brazilians, even the Africans to some extent. So the demand for cement went up. Demand for steel went up. Demand for coffee. Chinese were not drinking coffee. They were drinking tea. Because coffee was too expensive, it was a luxury. But because they became richer, the demand for coffee went up. Transport and housing and hotels were liberalized. And when these sectors were liberalized, by removing the role of the state companies, they have performed miracles. We sold government buses. You know, the government was owning buses. So I said, why should the government own buses? They sell these buses of the government and hotels, for instance. That act of removing government from the sector of transport and hospitality has stimulated a total of 1,685 private buses. These were the figures of 2015. 10,940 taxis. $1 million border, you know, piki-pikis, and so on. And 3,000 private hotels. We used to have a few hotels run by what they were calling Uganda Hotels, a government company. It had a few hotels, you could count them. Crested Crane in Jinja 1, Rock Hotel in Tororo 1, the 2, Eragon, the other one in Eragon 3, a miserable one in Soroti 4. There were like 5 or 6 hotels, government, Uganda hotels. So when we removed the government from hotels, now according to these figures, there are 3,000 private hotels, mainly by Ugandans. Because remember, these Ugandans, because you are talking of transformation. Transformation is a cattle keeper. I've been keeping cows for the last 7,000 years. But now, because of the government creating a new situation, some of my children, not me, I'm still stuck with cows. But some of my children have now gone from cows to hotels. That is transformation now. They have gone from what I was and what we have been for the last 7,000 years. I've been keeping count, my group has been keeping count for the last 7,000 years. But now, some of them have gone into hotels, some have gone into factories. This is a transformation we should be talking about. The society to change. All these private sector-led efforts employ a total of 2 million Ugandans. I'm talking about the ones, the transport and the hotels. Not the factories, but the transport and the hotels. 2 million Ugandans are working in those companies. The NRM took a pioneer role in defogging this issue, because it is fog, you create fog on issues, fog. What do you call fog in Swahili? Ukungu unatufunika kwenye macho. Education imparts literacy, numeracy, intellectuality, and skills. When you say education, what will education do? Reading, numbers, counting, intellectuality, being intellectual, but also in some cases skills. So it is an important transformative agent. Such a product is totally different from the pre-capitalist populations that still dominate Africa. This is where I had a problem with the World Bank. Because the World Bank, we are talking of private sector-led growth, just like that. Then I told them, I said, but my father is not part of the private sector. Until 1989, my late father was part of the pre-capitalist traditional sector, where they didn't care about money so much. Just produce for eating, you produce, you eat, you produce, you eat. So for the World Bank to sit here, private sector, what? Yes, but my father was not part of the private sector. It was only 1989 when we commercialized milk, because at that time, Uganda was not producing its own milk for the towns. The milk for the towns was coming as powdered milk from Denmark. They put in water here, water of Lake Victoria, and they stamp it Uganda Dairy Corporation. The dairy there is the water. And yet, my father was a cattle keeper. But he was not linked with the town. He was not selling his milk to the town. This man had been born in 1916. So you can see by 1989, the man was like in his 70s. But he had never been part of the capitalist system. But he had never been part of the money system. The money system was there, he was there. They were not linked. It was only when we commercialized the milk, we said you can produce milk, supply Kampala, that my father now became part of the, in his last years, part of the money economy. So, education, such a product, is totally different from the pre-capitalist populations that still dominate Africa. The pre-capitalist peasants only produce for homestead consumption. They have still not acquired the useful concept of profit. That difference between the cost price and the selling price, if I remember my arithmetic of P4, 1956, that concept of profit, many of the villagers don't have that concept. Indeed, Adam Smith wrote that the pre-capitalist man is a jack of all trades and a master of none. He writes as follows on page 13-14 in his book, The Source of the Wealth of Nations. It is impossible, he was writing in old English, which is a bit different from the English of today. It is impossible for pearls very quickly from one kind of work to another kind. You read this quotation, but what he meant is that the man in the village, in the pre-capitalist system, the remaining strategic bottlenecks are ideological disorientation, where emphasis is put on identity rather than on interests, leading to sectarianism. I don't have time to go into that, but you know my views on that, and I have already written on that many times. That sectarianism creates a weak state that cannot guarantee security, a sine qua non of private sector growth. Because if you, for instance, like we had here in the 1960s, what Dr. Gwenda was telling you, the sectarianism was around 2 points: religion and tribes. At independence, we had 3 political parties. 1 party for the Catholics, another party for the Protestants, a 3rd party for the Baganda tribe, one of the tribes. And by 1964-5, there was already a crisis. Because all these parties were identity parties, parties based on identity. Now, since all these identities are minorities, the Catholics were a minority in Uganda. The Protestants were a minority. The Baganda were a minority. If you take that line, you could not get enough numbers to support you to run a government, number one. That's why, therefore, they had to have a coalition. 1962, they didn't, no party could get enough number. They had to have a coalition. But moreover, they could also not build institutions like the army. When you try to build the army, you say, what religion is he? What tribe is he? They can't build an army. And if you don't have an army, you don't have a state. You don't have a state. And if you don't have a state to guarantee business, private sector, how will you talk about transformation? How will you talk about transformation? So that's why, apart from liberating the private sector, education, we say that ideological disorientation is another obstacle to transformation. We call it a bottleneck. And it leads to another bottleneck, a weak state. A state that cannot have enough strength to guarantee peace and development. Lack of infrastructure, such as electricity, the railways, etc., which results in high costs of doing business in an economy that undermines the profitability of the companies. If you don't have electricity, companies cannot come because they will not be able to make profit. A narrow internal market that cannot absorb the products of large-scale manufacture of goods and expansion of services. Our elders have tried to handle this since the Lagos Plan of Action. After some years of independence, they realized that if you do not integrate the market, you cannot move very far. Recently in Uganda, we had a huge crop of maize, 5 million tons. But Ugandans only eat 1 million tons. So the surplus, because the marketing is not well organized and the value addition is also not very well organized, we had a big surplus and the prices collapsed. Any product you talk about, I was visiting a number of factories the other day. All of them produce, like I was visiting a factory of tires and tubes for motorcycles. They are producing 10,000 tires a day, but Uganda consumes only 3,000. So there is a surplus of 7,000. So if you don't solve the issue of the regional market, market integration, these industries will never grow. They will all collapse, and the transformation will never take place. So therefore, market integration is part of the transformation, of the stimuli for transformation. The export of raw materials where we get only 10% of the value of the product and lose jobs. That one you have talked about very many times. This shirt I'm putting on is Ugandan from cotton to wear. That's why I'm putting it on. I pity the Ugandans who are suffering from foreign clothes. But for me, I'm insisting on this one. And a kilo of cotton, if you sell it as lint, you get like $1. But if you make a shirt out of it, the same kilo will give you about $15. So in every kilo, Africa, if you don't process, is losing maybe $10 in each kilo of cotton or kilo of coffee. So apart from education and the private sector-led growth, there are other bottlenecks which you will see in the speech that need to be resolved in order for the African society to be transformed. Awareness of the issues raised above is very crucial for Africa's transformation. Addressing the above issues will enable us to create prosperity for our people. How? By our producers generating a lot of goods and services, service products that find a ready market. The more we sell, the more we produce. The more we produce, the more jobs we create, and the wider the tax base. The more taxes we collect, the better social service the African governments will provide. Today, the African population is 1.25 billion, with a purchasing power of 6.7 trillion. By 2050, this population will be 2.5 billion. Uganda alone will be 102 million people. With a much bigger purchasing power, Africa will be the engine of the world economy, provided we resolve the bottlenecks. I thank you.